Well, folks, welcome to Denver. Welcome to the Rocky Mountain Audio Fest. I want to thank you on behalf of everyone for attending. How many are new to this event? First time? Oh, great. Outstanding. Okay. A little bit about us. My name is John Klintz. I want to call attention to the name of our company, the Soundsmith, and also the location, Johns Creek, Georgia. Okay. My wife and I run a successful custom installation AV business in Johns Creek, Georgia. We've been doing it for about 15 years now. We have nothing to do with and are not affiliated whatsoever with Soundsmith, just that one word, in upstate New York. Now, I have a very high respect for Peter and his associates and what they do, but we're not connected with them in any fashion. In fact, we had our name registered with the state and county in which we do business years before I even became aware of them. So I just wanted to clear the air there. My lovely wife here in front, Beverly, she helps me. I could not do this without her. This is my avocation, my hobby business, if you will. I truly enjoy doing this. My career for the last 35 plus years has been in the auto industry, on the wholesale as well as retail side. And speaking of wholesale, I have spent the last 24 years with Toyota Motor Sales USA, primarily in the Lexus division. Doing that, and during that time, I've had the opportunity in different positions to present, get involved in adult learning, prepare curriculum, and so forth, which is one of the reasons I'm here. I truly enjoy doing this. I enjoy public speaking, and I enjoy facilitation. So that's why I'm here. That's why we're here. So that's a little bit about us and what we do. Another thing, I want to give a little caveat here. If I mention something here in the during the seminar, a product, a service, a publication, does not mean that I necessarily endorse them. It's just something that has worked for me. I am not paid or endorsed by any of them. I am not, oh, we need to get rid of that? Okay, good. We're not paid or endorsed by any of them. Don't have anything to do with any of them. So just to clear that as well. So, primary topics today to start up. How to effectively engage other people in our hobby. We've got to keep doing that, folks, to keep it going. We want to keep it going. And how to assist them, and perhaps yourself, in maximizing the performance and enjoyment of your gear. This is a macro view, okay? It's an overview, a survey, if you will. I'm not going to get into a lot of details. So if this is why you came, this makes sense, then welcome. If it doesn't, feel free to leave at any time. You won't offend me, really. Tomorrow afternoon, Ken Kessler is going to do a more detailed how to set up a budget audio file system in tough economic times, along with Andrew Jones and some of the panel discussion. I'm going to be in that seminar. It's going to be in this room. I recommend you all are as well. Okay, that gets into more detail. So if that's what you're looking for, just a little plug for that one, because I was kind of excited when I saw that. So let's start by busting a few myths, okay? How many times have you heard that, huh? Is that true? Think so? He doesn't. I don't either. If you think it is, take a look on eBay at what vintage gear is bringing. Try to buy a mid-70s Marantz receiver, for example. See what you pay for it. Or Audiogon. Take a look at what Mapleshade is doing, purchasing probably from garage sales, old H. Scott and Sherwood and Fisher tube receivers and refurbishing them. See what those bring. How come? Because they do it right. A good design is a good design, period, whether it occurred in 1970 or 2010. So yeah, sometimes it can be better, sometimes it's not. How about this one? I've heard this repeatedly in my work. I mean, I really like these kind of people because they're the ones that fall first. They're the ones that say, oh, now, come on, you guys are crazy. There's no difference. All you got to do is put on a vinyl LP on a reasonable system and fire it up, and within about 5 minutes, those are the ones going, believe this. What? What's this? And then about 5 minutes more, and they're on the edge of their seat going, this is incredible. I said, whoa, wait a minute. You told me you couldn't hear a difference. How about this? You know, the real thing, what we need to do is be fair. We get a bunch of non-trained, non-audiophile types and put them all in a room, and then we'll do, play a passage of music and change something, play it again. And if they can tell a difference, then by golly, there's a difference. If they can't, then forget it. It's smoke and mirrors. Really? Think that makes sense? Did you come here unprepared? I bet you didn't. Let me use an example from the car business. Let's just say that you wanted to purchase a new luxury sports sedan. And you're looking around and you narrowed it down to a BMW 3 Series, an Audi A4 Quattro, and the new Lexus 2014 ISF Sport. So you've narrowed it down to those three. So being in the car business, I know from our research, over 80% of the people, before they walk into any dealership showroom, do some type of research online. 80% of the buyers. And that's not to say other research, you know, print and other research, but 80%. So you do your research and you figure out that the Audi Quattro is noted for its all-wheel drive and its five-valve turbocharged engine. BMW 3 Series now has a new turbocharged engine with start-stop technology. And by golly, this new IS, wow, they've tweaked the suspension. It handles like it's painted on, and it's got this exotic car-type dashboard. Wow, that's got to be cool. So you do your research, and you go to the dealerships, and you drive these vehicles, and you figure out what makes sense for you, what's most important, and you make your purchase. So you come a little educated, right? Is that not being objective? Of course it is. Do the same thing here. Educate yourself. Think about it. Learn as much as you can. When you're trained, you know how to evaluate. That's one thing. When you're listening to your music at home, bring it with you, your own music. You know what it's supposed to sound like. Oh, I need to spend quite a lot of money, right? How often have you heard that? Okay. One of the guys I was reading recently, one of the journals said that he went to one of these audio shows, and the average, in all the rooms, everybody was saying, well, this is a $20,000 system. He kept hearing that. So he added it up. The average cost of the systems at that show, wasn't this one, it was another one, was $20,000. And he said, unfortunately, I didn't hear a whole lot of really nice stuff. So I'm going to show you how you don't have to spend a whole lot of money. It's not how much, it's how you spend it. Our niche, where we work, is maximizing people's systems. I like to squeeze every last bit of performance out of every hard-earned dollar that our clients spend. That's what we do. A lot of times I walk into someone's house, I say, you know what, you really don't need anything. What do you mean? I thought I was going to have to spend a bunch of money. I said, well, you're going to have to spend some money paying me to maximize your system, but that's about it. And generally, they're happy. After all, you get what you pay for, right? Your Uncle Ernie told you this, right? Do you? I'm going to show you some ways where you can get more than you pay for. And sometimes you get less, a lot less. Okay? So that's not always true either. Oh, if it's popular, it must be good, right? Oh, shoot, everybody's doing it. How many here are messing around with Pandora? I'm wasting time with that. Why? You're an audiophile. What's the reason for that? Convenience, right? You like the ability to create a personalized radio station, right? I like that too. But there's so many other better services out there that do similar or the same thing with a lot higher quality. If you haven't figured it out, we drive this industry, the audiophiles, and we drive quality. So I support services, products, and companies that do that. We vote with our dollars. So I'm not going to pay for Pandora's so-called premium service because it takes it from 128 kilobits per second, which I don't want to waste time doing that. Life's too short, to 192. Whoopee! That's like a McDonald's burger with mustard and pickles. I don't eat at McDonald's. I don't know about you, but I don't. And I'm not going to start doing Pandora. Okay? There's other ones. It's on my resource guide. Check them out. More is always better, right?
More watts.
More. Let's talk about watts for a minute. Okay, you look at an AV receiver or a stereo receiver or an integrated amplifier and it says 100 watts per channel. Okay? Read the fine print. Generally, the cheapy ones will say 100 watts per channel, one channel driven at 1 kilohertz with 0.1% total harmonic distortion. What does that tell me about the capabilities of that amplifier stage in there? Absolutely nothing. It means it can generate a 1 kilohertz tone at a sound pressure level that uses 100 watts. That's it. Look at the quality stuff. They will read something like 100 watts per channel, both channels driven, from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, largely acknowledged as the range of human hearing, with 0.1% total harmonic distortion. That tells me, that doesn't tell me it's going to sound wonderful or even good, but it does tell me that that amplifier stage is capable of delivering pure, clean sound. Now, what happens after that, you know, and this connectivity features, this has been driving me crazy the last 2 or 3 years with AV receivers. I've been extremely disappointed in the trend. They feel like, you know, they're built to a price, and they feel like they have to include every type of so-called connectivity feature and then processing on top of that available. So it's got to have Bluetooth, and it's got to have DLNA, and it's got to have Apple AirPlay, by golly, and be connected this, that, and the other, and streaming, and iPod plug-in. And then you put in a DSP chip that processes all this, and you can choose two different kinds of processing and add them together, and guess what the result is? Pretty much crappy sound. That's been my experience. Because by putting all those features in this receivers, and unfortunately, the majority of end users use maybe one of those features, certainly not all of them. By putting them in there, other things have to suffer. What suffers? Build quality and sound quality. Power supplies aren't as robust as they need to be. Amplifier stages aren't either, and build quality suffers. There are a few manufacturers still doing it right, a few good things. Take your pick. One has already included Wi-Fi. That's all they use, Wi-Fi. And I think that's smart. I like Wi-Fi. So, all right, this is the way you connect this one. You want to connect with DLNA, buy something else. And I think that's the smart trend. We've got to get over this, guys, because this still is kind of true. But you know what? I've been seeing a lot more ladies this time. That happened last year, and this year especially. I've been keep mentioning it to my wife. All afternoon I've been watching it, and that's really a good trend. And if you haven't noticed, this wonderful event that is organized and put on every year is done by a director who is a very professional, seasoned, committed audiophile who happens to be a woman. Can anybody say, duh? Guys, we gotta wake up. What are the basics? I like this term, AV system roadmap. This is the term Jim Smith uses in his book, Get Better Sound. I like this book a lot. It's like 250 tips of how to improve your system. I don't know about you, but I can't look at blueprints and envision something. Some people can. My wife is much better at that than I. It just doesn't connect. But I like roadmap because it's a journey. And I can say, all right, I'm going to go from here to here and then take a break. And then I'll get back on and maybe I'll change direction here. And that's why I like this concept. Always remember when you're starting is keep the main thing the main thing. Now, this sounds terribly trite, perhaps overly simplistic, I know. But this is what happens. You get sidetracked, distracted, off onto a tangent, and you forget what your original objective was, what you're trying to do, and you might even get frustrated and not do anything. Don't do that. Keep the main thing the main thing. What do you want to do? I've had clients say, well, I want music run over the house. Why? Well, I listen to music in my kitchen. Well, what do you want? Do you want it to sound like the grocery store? Or do you want to do active listening at some point? Well, no, I want to listen to music. Okay. then instead of tearing up your walls and your ceiling and spend a bunch of money, why don't you put in a good audio system in another room? And when you're cooking in your kitchen, just turn it up or build a small system just for your kitchen. We did that. We remodeled our kitchen about a year and a half ago. Let's put a small system in our kitchen. Just do that. That's what we've done actually in our two-channel listening room, which is our living room. And when we have people over and for dinner and everything in the dining room, I just turn it up a little bit. So it's background music. And I have a remote extender in my dining room so I can mute it, whatever I need to do. And that makes a whole lot more sense because when we go in there, we can actively listen to music on that system. It's a nice system. We can go enjoy it as well. Now, one of my clients, he said, hey, all I want is a speaker in the bathroom. I said, Chuck, that's enough. I said, why do I want to put a speaker in there? He said, because I want to hear the news in the morning. Okay, so that's what we did. Put a speaker in his bathroom. Okay? That's why I asked. What are you trying to improve? What is your system not doing? What are you trying to get it to do? Should you consider changing or upgrading? Maybe. How about doing something first before rushing to buy something? In other words, avoid audiophilia nervosa. Anybody know what that is? You nodded. She says, yeah. This seems to strike middle-aged men. And what it is a syndrome which causes us to believe that we have to constantly change something in our system, whether or not it's an upgrade. You have to keep buying stuff and changing stuff, okay? Why not maximize what you have first, okay? And with that, I have, oh, I forgot to get it out, darn it. Pardon me for a minute. I have a little comment from John Marks in this month's Stereophile, October 2013, where he talks about just that, maximizing your system. It's called getting your money's worth. And rather than paraphrase it, I thought I'd just read a few sentences here. He says, long experience has convinced me that many audiophile stereo systems substantially underperform compared to what they could sound like. This is not because people haven't spent enough money, there's that one again, on their electronics or speakers. Instead, people aren't getting all the performance they've paid for because they haven't devoted enough attention to all aspects of the initial setup and or to maintenance and updating. Reduced to its essentials, a stereo system is a machine designed to convert the electricity that comes out of your wall outlet into mechanical motion by the loudspeakers, which create sound in your listening room. I run into this all the time. And even with video monitors, we do AV too, TV setups and all that stuff. It happened about 2 weeks ago at a friend's house for dinner, and you know they got a new HDTV, how come our picture is so crappy? They had an HD DVR. They were paying for HD service. They weren't getting it. I said, well, let me mess with it a little bit. Come to find out, it wasn't cabled properly. Just wasn't cabled properly. Once they did that, all of a sudden get HD. That's happened repeatedly. Okay, so have you completely maximized potential before you spend money? If you don't, how else will you know if it's an upgrade or not? 4S the gear. This comes from I'm a process consultant now. That's what I do for Toyota. We work on certain processes and principles that help selected dealerships maximize their efficiencies. And one of the principles is 5S. If you're clearing out something, it's called 5S. Sort, sweep, scrub, systemize, standardize. I shortened it for this too. Sort, sweep, scrub, then systemize. So you sort out things, get rid of cables and components that aren't being used, okay? Sweep that away, scrub, clean connectors, use contact cleaner, and then follow it up with keg deoxit. There's other stuff out there that's more expensive. I'm not sure anything works better than that. I've used it for years, keg deoxit. It not only cleans the contacts, it molecularly bonds to them to make an actually better contact than it was when it was new. You can get it at Parts Express. Those guys are right out in the lobby and other places. Then systemize, make it a system. Maybe you want to include a remote or something, okay? Pay attention to things like AC power delivery. These expensive power cords are one of my pet irritations, if not consternations. We'll talk a little bit more about that later. But power delivery is very important. One of the best things you can do for your system in terms of upgrading the power is rather than spend megabucks on a line filter or power cord combination, hire an electrician to come out and run a dedicated 20-amp circuit to your system. I did that about a year and a half ago to my home cinema system as well as our listening room. This will make a more significant and noticeable and lasting difference than any $500 or less line filter power conditioner I can think of. That's just, where does it make sense to spend the money? Also, the outlet. You're going to build a $4,000 or $5,000 or $6,000 AV system or stereo system, and you're going to plug it into a 49-cent outlet? Does that make sense? No. Those are designed for lamps, not this. Audio Advisor and some of the others have really nice Parts Express outlets that run about $50. You don't even spend $50, but about $50. I have one. That made a significant difference. It clamps onto the prongs of the power cord much better. So you eliminate resistance, which causes heat and noise in your system. So if you don't want to spend $50, that's okay. Go to your hardware store and look for a hospital-grade outlet or something like that. Expect to spend around $8. That will make a difference. Like I said, if you don't do these things first, how will you know if your change was truly an upgrade? Get rid of the stuff. Find a place to put it, families, members, you know, wherever. Start, if you're starting from scratch or upgrading, decide what's the priority. Where should you spend most of your hard-earned cash? Should you consider pre-owned gear? I think so. I've purchased stuff off of AudioGon. I've sold stuff on AudioGon. AudioGon and their sister website, VideoGon, that's with a G-O-N, really, really good source. A lot of stuff on eBay, this gets rid of the chatter and the noise. This gets down to really audiophile, videophile grade components. And these are folks that are going through audiophilia nervosa, and you can benefit by it. I have, and other people have. So, and they're here too, AudioGon. Go check them out. What's a good balance? Okay, what about diminishing returns? Give you an example. I said we put a system in our kitchen. About a year and a half ago, I built this little system, and I'm not going to show it or talk about it because the components that I used at the time are no longer available, unfortunately. But essentially, I have about $750 in the system, okay? And I will put it up against anything you can assemble here up to and about $2,500. It does create an emotional impact. It's a pleasurable to listen to from an audiophile standpoint, and it's simple and easy to use. Okay? Our other system in our listening room is about $6,000. Some of the stuff I got wholesale for being in the industry is about $6,000 or so. One time my wife said, you know, we were listening to our kitchen system. She said, this sounds really nice. She said, obviously, the room, in the listening room, that system sounds better, and it does, but is it 10 times better? Nope, it's not. So that happens. One of the principles we use in this process that I do is called Genchi Genbutsu. Go look and see for yourself. If you're questioning something, go look and see. Okay? I've just expanded. Go look, see, and hear. You have ample opportunity to do that today and this weekend here. Decide what your priorities are and go take a look. When auditioning a new piece of equipment, take your music. You know what it's supposed to sound like. Trust yourself, your ears. Jim Smith said this about 3 years ago. He was here. He was at a panel discussion, and he said this. And I got to squirming in my seat. I was out in the audience. I said, wait a minute. And I like audiophile effects, imaging and soundstage and nuances and detail and prat, like the British like to speak of, pace, rhythm, attack, and timbre. I like that. What are you talking about, Jim? This is more important, he said. Dynamics. High, soft periods and loud. Okay? So how well does it do that? And if you've got a line filter in your system that's limiting current, it might cut off both ends of that. Be careful about that. So dynamics, tone. Does the oboe sound like an oboe, or does it sound like a flat clarinet? Does the piano sound like a piano? And rhythm, is the bass going along with everything else, or is it disjointed? Like some subsat systems are set up there. You hear, if you try to play music on them, it's ba-boom, ba-boom, ba-boom. When I hear that, I know that the subwoofer is out of phase immediately. And you can correct that. That's something correctable. Audiophile effects versus emotional involvement. So what do you want? First, I want that emotional involvement first, and then we'll talk about imaging, soundstage, all of those things. Jim Smith said when he used to come to shows like this, he used to bring his, they had a store, and he'd bring his people and his sales consultants, and they would go around, and they had a little process that they followed called the around the corner test. And what they do is they'd walk up to a room, and if the music coming out of that room was made them want to go in and listen more, creating that emotional impact, they go in and listen. If not, they'd walk right on by and go to the next one. When I was here last year, I was walking around, and I got to tell you, there was one room that did not pass the around the corner test. And I did go in there momentarily after I listened. I went in there momentarily, and I'll bet you there was 50 grand worth of equipment in there. And it was accurate, and it was detailed, but it was sterile. And it didn't want to make me stay in there and listen to it for more than about a minute. That was enough. Now, contrast that with our first trip here. My wife and I came, our first time here in 2010, we came on a Saturday morning, and we'd heard, several... hope I can get rid of this. I don't know why. Sorry about that. Oh. Yeah, should have, huh? Yeah. So we had listened to some really nice sounding equipment that morning. And some of it, quite honestly, did start to create the emotional impact. I bet we'd listened to 5-6 systems. We were walking around in one of the exhibit rooms. I was looking for one of the particular companies. We were walking around. We walked up to this one room, and we stopped. And I turned to her, and I said, tubes and vinyl. I didn't even go in the room. I said, tubes and vinyl. And we walked in there, and there was this gorgeous turntable, spinning vinyl through tube amplification into some really nice bookshelf monitors. How did I know that? Because the other systems sounded like really, really nice musical reproduction. That room sounded like a live band in the room, and that was the difference. Emotional impact. Does the system disappear? Does it give you a sense of you are there, or they are here? Give you another example. We had a little church group meeting at our house about a year ago, and a couple came that had never been to our house before, and I... And we have these get-together. We have a dinner, and we eat, and we socialize, and that's what we were doing. And I had some music playing in the listening room, and I was sitting in the dining room visiting with people. And the music stopped, so I got up, and I went in, and I thought, I'm going to kick it up a notch or two. So I went in, and I grabbed Mannheim Steamroller Fresh Air. They did 4 or 5 of these albums. Not Christmas music, it's just really nice. And it's nice background music. It's also nice to actually actively listen. There's good piano music in it. I mean, so I threw that on the turntable, fired up, came back in the dining room, and started talking to these people again. And this lady that I was talking to stopped, and she said, who's playing the piano? And I said, Martha, we don't have a piano. So that's a recording. She said, wow, who is it? And I told her, I said, that's on a vinyl disc. That's why it sounds so nice. Now, she didn't say, wow, this sounds good. Who is it? Or this is a nice recording. No. She said, who's playing the piano? That's the emotional impact. Come to find out, she's an accomplished pianist herself and knows what a piano is supposed to sound like. So I felt pretty good about that, quite frankly. But you're developing a roadmap, okay? So tweaks it make sense. Cables, cleans, all this stuff. You can spend a lot of money on cleaners for your Blu-ray discs and CDs and stuff. What works just fine is go get some plastic lens cleaner and dilute it 50-50 with distilled water. I've been using that for 10, 12 years. Read that in one of my nerd publications, and it works just great. You want to polish them up a little more, extract every last bit of sound or video quality out of them. Two products I recommend. One's called Optics, which is actually a finisher, and one's called Micro Smooth, which is actually a polish. Maple Shade has both of those. Both those companies are on my resource guide, okay? Or the Maple Shade is on my resource guide, and they have both of them. Optics is actually available, I think, from Parts Express and from Audio Advisor and some of the other companies as well. That stuff works without getting too carried away with this. And then there's smoke miracle mirrors and miracle cures, and you've seen this stuff, and so have I. These guys that run these thick cables that look like they would carry enough current to light the city of Denver through, and they put on things called cable risers, these little ceramic things, and they set this up, and it looks pretty impressive and looks really nice, but what does it do for sound quality? Some of them probably won't like me, but not a lot that I've heard. Not a whole lot. And big, huge plinths to set your stuff on, and they're aesthetically really nice, and I guess if you got a six-figure system, that makes sense. But if you got a $600 system, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense at all. So what makes sense? You got to listen to live music. Last time you attended a concert, were you able to connect? What'd you think of the next day? Did you get an earworm from it in a good way, a good earworm? You know, like one of those hokey commercial songs. Were you able to emotionally connect? You have to set aside time to listen to live music. I'm going to recommend one here that we heard last year. Fan Yalin, this Chinese lady that plays the piano, is incredible. We heard her last year play in the atrium, and all of the noise and commotion and people going through there stopped when she was playing. I don't know when I have seen so much energy and virtuosity come out of such a small person. She is incredible. I recommend it. I walked right over when she finished and bought her CD. There's others here as well that I'm sure are just as accomplished. So take time to listen to live music. My wife and I do that. We support, in Johns Creek, the Johns Creek Symphony Orchestra. We go listen to them. They're not, you know, Atlanta Symphony quality or Denver Symphony quality, but they're pretty good. But we support them because you got to listen, you got to do that to judge how well you're doing at home. When was the last time you listened to an album all the way through? You have to make time for it. It has to be an event. Active listening takes some effort, but there's a therapeutic effect as well. So don't dumb it down with other stuff, other distractions. A lot of times my wife and I, at the end of a long week, we'll go into the listening room and sit down. She'll read. I'll read. Sometimes I read. Sometimes I just listen. But we'll go in there and read and listen to music. And many times she'll be reading, and she'll just stop and say, I really like this part of the music. Or, I really like this recording. Which one is it? Or whatever. Because it gets your attention. But you can do that. We got to do this. Pardon me. I've got to get a little water here. I'm getting hoarse. There we go. So how are we going to do this? Well, how about engaging some younger listeners? This can be kind of tough. You might not understand them. You might think they're crazy. They think we're crazy, some of them. Okay? How do they listen? You know, with earbuds, right? What do they listen to? Not sure, but most of it is not very high resolution, is it? I'm not trying to be disparaging or pejorative in this statement, but many of them, regardless of age, don't know what they don't know. It's as simple as that. And you're there to help guide them along, okay? So, once you do, and I'll warn you this too, once you do, you're likely to get this response, because I have. Great, John, I do hear the difference, and that's kind of cool, but it doesn't matter to me. So back goes the earbuds, and off they go. And that's okay. You'll get 20% that'll say, wow, this is really cool. Can you help me do this? Yeah. Those are the ones you zero in on. Okay? What's our expression of freedom? When I was growing up, our expression of freedom and, in some respects, identity was the car, right? You got a car. Wow. I was a junior in high school, my first car. We'll talk about that later if we have time, if you want, and what I did. I mean, now, automobile companies are scratching their heads. They're doing all kinds of research. Young people aren't even getting driving licenses. And some of them are saying, well, it's because there's not enough technology, which I think is a crock. And some of them are saying, well, it's because of this or it's that. Bottom line, I've read two research studies recently that I think nailed it, and I agree with them. Cars are too expensive. They can't afford them, even pre-owned cars. They can't afford them. So they're saying, heck with it. So what are they spending their money on, and what is their expression of freedom? What apps do you have? What are you using? Okay? That's what it is. Therefore, how do they communicate? You better get used to that. Talk to the screen. Okay? You learn to talk to the screen, you're going to learn to communicate with them. What do I mean? Well, go find. Learn to text if you don't know how. If you do, go find a website that they like. So I'm going to say, hey, have you seen this on YouTube? Pull something up. That's what I've done with a couple of friends of ours, one of the teenagers, and that engages him. I'll do that almost every time I see him. Hey, you seen this? No, hey, that's pretty cool. He calls me John Uncle. He says, that's pretty cool. Then he'll start talking to me, but not before. Then they'll talk to you. They'll talk to you about this stuff. But that's what you have to do. What's important to them? Guess what? Customization, personalization. That's why they like Pandora. I got my own personalized radio station. Wow. Before it was, hey, look at the cool wheels I bought for my car. Now I got my own personalized radio station. You got to customize it for them. So even when you're talking to them, zero in on what they like. We say this in the car business all the time. When I do presentations, I keep reminding them of this. I can talk to you for an hour about how great the new 2014 ISF Sport is, and how wonderful it drives, and this, that, and this. What's the best thing I could do? What's that? Absolutely. Give you a couple of pointers and toss you the keys. Go for a drive. You know, ring it out and come back and tell me what you think. That's the way you do it. Choose your words carefully. You know, what are you going to do? Walk up to one of these kids and say, how come you're listening to those crappy earbuds? I don't think that's the way to win friends and influence people, okay? Choose it carefully. You'd be amazed. I do a little DJing just for fun in our neighborhood and stuff, and I can't tell you how many times I do this, and the 20-somethings come up, and the first thing they say is, oh, you spin wax! That's what they call it. That's vinyl, okay? And then they want to go through my collection and start talking about it, and that's how you engage them. Don't get too technical and geeky, you know. Well, Frank, you know what's wrong with your system is you need a 24-192 DAC, and you got too much jitter in here, and that's affecting the high frequency. What's Frank going to say? What's a DAC? And why do I need one? Keep it simple. Ladies like music too, don't you? Absolutely. I've done some research. You can argue, but go look it up yourself. They typically have better hearing ability than us, especially as we age. They don't lose it like we do. Okay? There is an organization called Classic Album Sundays. It started in Great Britain 10, 15 years ago with lady audiophiles. One lady started it for women. And one Sunday afternoon a month, they got together and listened all the way through to a classic album. Not necessarily classic cull, but classic album. Like they'd take Dark Side of the Moon or Beatles Abbey Road, one of those, and listen all the way through. And she'd prompt them and coach them what to listen for in the album and this kind of stuff. Well, it grew. And then they started having branch groups out from that. And now it's spread to the U.S. And they're doing it in cities in the U.S. And they started inviting guys. I think the last 4 or 5 years, they started inviting guys to it, come too. And their website is on my reference guide. And it's a cool website. I recommend you go there. And Anybody here who takes Stereophile? Everybody? Stereophile reading? Who doesn't like Stephen Mejia's, his writing? I hope I meet him. I hope he's here this time. I want to meet this guy. I've totally enjoyed his little expository writing, if you will, of his forays into this with Natalie and Nicole and Ms. Little and the Audio Cats. He has engaged these young ladies and turned them into budding audiophiles just by showing them the difference and demoing and having fun with them and offering to go DJ parties for him and stuff. That's what he does. And I really enjoy his writing. Best practices. If you share with someone else, maybe you'll learn something and you can tweak your best practices. Okay? So what about budgets? Look at this. 1968, the average spent on a hi-fi system, according to some things I read, was about $225, okay? Guess what? A lot of people, that's what they spend now in 2013 dollars, don't they? They buy an iPod dock or a wave radio. Does that really give room-filling sound? Well, we all know better than that. That's why we're here, right? Okay. So can I build truly an engaging audiophile system for that? Yes. Let me show you two. And there's more. This is one. Starting with that receiver. Why did I pick that? Because it's got the right stuff inside. Toroidal power supply, cast heat sinks. It's heavy. It's got both a moving coil and moving magnet phono stage, audiophile grade phono stage. It's got a USB DAC all built in, okay? It gets great reviews whenever people review it, all the journalists that have reviewed it, and it just looks so darn cool. It is the coolest looking stereo receiver out there. It looks like a high-end component. It doesn't look like a cheap piece of junk you picked up at one of the big box retailers. It's a nice piece, okay? Why the W2 streamer for Apple devices? This is two pieces. You click one to your Apple device, your iPod or your iPhone or your iPad, and the other you plug into your receiver. And it streams Wi-Fi, no Bluetooth, no stuff that's going to destroy it. It streams Wi-Fi, so if you have full resolution files stored on this thing, you can stream in just darn near CD quality to it. That's what's $49. Come on. Pioneer SB20. This is on Amazon. $129. The pair. I have a pair. They're unbelievable for that money. Andrew Jones. They contracted with Andrew Jones, who is a relatively famous speaker designer, to design these for him, design budget speakers. These little puppies perform. They punch way out of their league. He is going to be here tomorrow in that panel discussion at 1:45. Andrew Jones is actually going to be here. I didn't know that until today. I just found that out today. I'm going to be here. I'd love to tell him how much I like his speakers. I have a pair that I use for DJing in small rooms. And repeatedly, whenever I fire them up, people come up and say, man, those sound nice. And then when I tell them the price, they can't believe it. Project, a debut from Music Direct, who's here as well, $299. Again, you can spend all kinds of money on line filters and expensive ones. This is a budget system. I've used some more expensive ones. These trip lights do better than just about any of them. They don't seem to limit current, yet they clean stuff up and clean noise up as well or better than line filters and surge protectors that cost three times what they cost. You can get them from Parts Express. You can get them on Amazon. Okay, cables, internets, be careful there. This stuff can get into smoke and mirrors really quickly, particularly in budget systems. AudioQuest has introduced a new line of interconnects that starts with the tower. It's called the tower. It's AudioQuest bridge line, the tower, $25 for interconnects. Now, come on. That gets you at least off the bottom floor and into a decent interconnect for the money. It's a budget system. Remember that. Possible upgrades. Let's say you want a little nicer speaker, at least a little nicer looking speaker. Go to Wharfdale Nyman. Let's say you don't have an Apple device. You can go to the Audio Engine. Audio Engine's here, by the way, too. One of the guys left from Audio Engine. They build really quality stuff. Go see them. This W3 streamer, if you want to stream from your computer files. Upgrade the turntable, whatever. Okay, let's take a look at another one. This little Harman Kardon stereo receiver has gotten good reviews, $318 from Amazon. It's got a moving magnet phono stage and no USB DAC, so we're going to add the Audio Quest Dragonfly, which has gotten really good reviews recently, if we want to stream, $198 from Amazon. Again, the project debut, Auto Engine W2. And I've added this, the Pioneer Towers. These are those same as the bookshelves, the Andrew Jones, but these are the tower versions, $300 the pair off of Amazon. I put a pair of these in a client's family room about 2 months ago. And I got to tell you, they totally exceeded my expectations, blew him away. I was still working on his system when he left. He had to go to work. He works at night. So I finished it up, and I said, messed with it a while, and just listening to it, and I just left it on. He came home. He called me the next day twice. He called me. He said, I can't believe what I'm hearing. These things are awesome. Thanks. And he calls me like 3 hours later and say, this is unbelievable. You know, he just they just blew him away. And they will. I can't think of any tower speakers I've heard that cost twice that, that sound as nice as those. I if they're out there, I haven't heard them. And then the trip light and interconnects and all that. And let's just say this person isn't into streaming, so we will axe that. We'll start with a entry-level CD player. This little NAD 516 has gotten really good reviews. And we're going to add the Wi-Fi streamer, let's say, instead of the other one, because we're going to stream from a computer. You know, you do different things with this, okay? I'm not necessarily a John Wooden fan, but I do like his quotes. Just something to think about. So this is the idea here, okay? Engage, inspire, demonstrate, and then assist. Is vinyl really better? Vinyl is analog. I don't think it gets any better than that, personally. That's how we hear. We hear analog. I really like vinyl. But I'm also not opposed to high-resolution digital. I like it all, as long as it's quality. And I've learned that over the years. I just like high-quality audio. Do tubes sound better? I don't like when people say, well, this type of amplification sounds better. Amplifiers are supposed to get out of the way of the music and not color it. So the less the coloration, the better, as far as I'm concerned. Tubes reproduce signals in a linear fashion. That's how we hear. We don't hear digital or switching. We hear linear. And tubes, if you imagine a tone as a sine wave, they reproduce that totally with linearity. I like the way they reproduce music. I prefer that. Some people do, some people don't. Can I do that with a solid state system? Sure. If you run it in pure class A, but then they tend to build up a lot of heat. Most solid state systems at some point involve some switching. Class D amplifiers are switching from the get-go. And that affects sound quality. It starts with the source. So what's compression? One of the best descriptions of compression I ever heard was actually here about 3 years ago, where a guy was talking about this, and he said, would you go to a library or would you buy a book from a vendor where someone has gone through and removed 90% of the pages? Of course not. Well, then why do you buy your music that way? After the talk, I went up to him and I said, that's the best description of compression I have ever heard. And I said, with your permission, I'm going to use that. He said, use it. And I've been using it ever since. So it's a codec. If someone has decided to remove this stuff that they don't think you need. I don't like compression. So what about streaming? Well, if you stream Wi-Fi, it can be pretty good. What about the cloud? I don't use it. I'm skeptical right now. I'm one of these. I'm not an early adopter on these kinds of things. If you're having luck with it and it's working, great. Go for it. What's Bluetooth? Bluetooth wasn't originally designed for music. Okay? That's why most devices that stream Bluetooth, they call it Bluetooth audio. At that point, it ceases to be music. It's merely sounds. It's at 64 kilobits, and it's has all that talkback stuff that really messes up the audio stream. Even A2DP is merely Bluetooth stereo. So I haven't heard any Bluetooth audio devices worthy of more than about 30 seconds of my time. Now that could change. I know that Musical Fidelity has a new device out that uses XTS, this new Bluetooth codec that uses, it's at 384 kilobits, which is significantly better. Maybe it is. I don't know, I'm open to it, but right now, things are going Wi-Fi. Even cars are going Wi-Fi. So I save Bluetooth for printers and stuff like that rather than audio. That's my opinion. Okay? Got to change, got to keep with it. Let's tie it up. So use available resources. Remember this. What is that? Garbage in, garbage out. It starts with the source. I don't care what you do with 64 kilobit Bluetooth audio. It is never, ever, ever going to sound like music, period. I don't care what you do with it. Use your stories. As a challenge, mention one positive comment per week to someone about our hobby. That is my challenge to you all. So it's about the music. Don't forget that. Questions, comments. I have a few CDs left of this one we talked about before I started. There's three left if someone wants one. That our full resolution came from vinyl originally. Anybody have any questions, comments, critique?
Concerned, yes, about buying used equipment. I saw that, yeah, in your outline, and you, yeah, skipped past it.
Oh, did I? No, I just said that there's some concerns. I mentioned AudioGon because AudioGon is very safe. They have return policies and everything. And if people sell stuff on AudioGon and they don't meet up, they take them off their site. So make sure that you have some type of guarantee. You're using PayPal so that you can stop the payment, or some type of guarantee that you're going to get what you actually pay for. That's my concern. I've had absolutely no issues with AudioGon doing that. And there's some other sites that are actually as good as well. Anything else? Yes.
You mentioned the resource guide.
Yes, right here. So there's a few left of those as well. Come up and help yourselves. Anything else? This is fun stuff. Enjoy. Yes.
So you had a couple budget systems. What do some of your more expensive systems look like?
What are some more expensive systems? Well, like my two-channel listening room, for example. I'll put it up against anything that costs twice what I have in it. I have a Vincent MK236 or 236 MK integrated amp, which is a tube solid-state hybrid. I have the Musical Fidelity A308 CD player that I got off of AudioGon. The Vincent I bought new. I have a Music Hall MMF7, the original MMF7 turntable. Have the Vincent phono stage, separate phono stage and power supply connected to that. An old Fisher tuner that is really good that I bought from a guy in a whole set. I bought a number of stuff from him, just gave him and it was included in just a stack of stuff. I think I paid $100 for everything. The tuner, I gave everything else away, and the tuner turned out to be really good, so I kept it. And I have some Energy Veritas 2.3i towers. I used to sell those before Energy got absorbed into the Klintz group. These were the real original Veritas. And I'll tell you, they're about, 10 years old, 10, 11 years old? They still will, they rock. I don't care what kind of music you want to throw at them. They're detailed, they image, they have dynamic range, they have bass punch. They really do a nice job. So that's my more expensive system. My home cinema system is a little more elaborate as well. Yes? Anybody? Not a lot. I'm aware of it. I move subwoofers around. I move furniture around. If I go in a room and there's a lot of echo, you know, I always do the hand clap test. If there's a lot of echo, I recommend that people put down rugs and furniture. I've also recommended, I say, hey, you're going to put bookshelves in here? Well, yeah, okay, put some books in there. So it's basic with room acoustics. I do basic room acoustics. I've looked at some of the websites and some of the diagrams for it, but that's very important. If someone's building a room, the first thing I recommend, I'm going to remodel the basement. We're going to put a home theater room down there. It's okay. Have you put the studs up yet? No. In fact, I counseled a guy with this just about 4 or 5 months ago. I said, angle your side walls. He said, what are you talking about? I said, the front should be at least a quarter to a half an inch closer in than the back. Put it in a trapezoidal shape, not parallel. That tends to break up reflections already. Then add your other things, your acoustic treatments on the walls, whatever you want to add. So a little bit, but not much. Anyone else? Well, great. Thank you very much. That is my email address. If you all are interested in ever getting in touch with me, please feel free to do so. Okay? Otherwise, thank you very much.